I'm a little hesitant to say anything at this point. All right. Is that better? Yeah. Any of you have any hearing left after? Well, good morning. Good to see you this morning. A few announcements, and by a few, I mean a lot. I want to thank Betty for, she's got a sharp eye. We need to track down the clown who's doing these bulletins because yet another error in here. Our Saturday services, the next one will not be October 16th. We do not have a time machine. We're not going back in time. November 6th will be the next one. We had a wonderful one last night. Appreciate people that came. If you haven't come to one of our Saturday services, please do. I think you'll enjoy it. And that'll be November the 6th. If you know any children, you have any children, bring them also. We have an excellent Saturday Night Kids program going on. A cute lady in the back has been heading that up. So the one with the book in front of her face now, wishing that I would be quiet. That's my wife. Anyway. But be a part of that. It's an exciting thing to be a part of. Saturday nights, the first and third Saturday of every month. Okay, 6 o'clock, right here. Next fellowship luncheon, be November 3rd. Byron does a wonderful job heading that up. He'd love to have help, or maybe even you might want to take it over. Byron might not fight you on that. So, 12 o'clock, we start, so bring your food and have it all set up and ready to go so that we can be ready at 12. Young adults will meet on November 5th. Trunk or Treat is coming up on the 31st. And I know some of you have different views on Halloween. I'm actually not a very big fan of it, but one thing I am a fan of is kids walking right by our church. I want to get them on this property. I want to let them know there's people in this church that love and care about them. So we're asking that you have a car that you could decorate if you want. Nothing with blood and gore and disgusting demon-y type things, but decorate it, make it look nice if you want. But give out candy. We will have tracts, gospel tracts that we want to include that are geared for kids that could let them know a message of Christ's love for them. We want to be a part of that. So if you want to donate candy, that'd be fine. You want to donate money, give that to my wife, and she'll go buy candy. If you'd rather have somebody else buy the candy, she can do that. And if you'd like to have a car here, that would be fine as well. But that'll be on the 31st, right after the Halloween parade. It'll go right by here, okay? Fundraiser going on for the medical mission trip to Dominican Republic, the chocolate chip cookie fundraiser. There is a sign-up sheet out there. $10, and that gives you a dozen cookies, and all the funds go to the missions trip. So please take advantage of that. This is the last Sunday you can sign up for that to get the cookies for the 24th, I believe it is, so to pick them up. All right, so there is that. Also be in prayer about the Dominican Republic. I was watching the news this morning, and it says there's been some Americans abducted in Haiti, and they're talking about travel to that area being a problem, so I'm hoping that doesn't spill into the Dominican. So we're kind of right next door there. We don't want any trouble in the Dominican. So, although, if I just went alone and they abducted me, could be a win for some here, so... Anyway, any other announcements that I may be forgetting? Yes, Mr. Dean. Deacons meeting Tuesday at 10 a.m.? Fantastic. I love these morning meetings. I'm not going to lie to you. Anyone else? Any announcements I'm forgetting? Choir? Who? Yeah, that's... Oh, yeah. Choir on Wednesdays. You taking any new people? Always, yeah. Okay. So, always looking to up our game if you've got a voice to bring. Edith says, bring it. So, something like that. I can picture Edith saying that. Any other announcements? All right. Well, let's go ahead and begin our worship time. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the privilege that we have to gather in your name to offer up songs of worship and praise to you, to offer you prayers, bringing our requests and our praises, Lord. We thank you for a chance to hear from your word where we can be instructed and encouraged in our walk. Thank you for the fellowship that we have one with another, the love that we have because of the love we've received from you. Bless this day and bless this service, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Would you stand? Number 8 in your hymnal, Come Thou Almighty King. Be seated. How many of you as a parent ever punished your child by making them read Psalm 119? You clearly did not have the parents that I had. Psalm 119 is the longest chapter in Scripture. It's very long, and we're not going to read it all today. So we'll read 48 verses this morning, 24 now, and 24 in a little bit here. It is a real treasure if you work through this passage of Scripture and you see the psalmist declare the delight in the Word of God and the importance of the Word of God. I said this in the sermon at East Troy this morning, and it bears repeating, and that is that, friends, we don't need more people in this church that love the church. You know what we need? More people that love the Word of God. People who love the Word of God are people that you want in your church. And in fact, who would you want leading your church, your committees, your boards, your whatever? You want people that love the Word of God, that are people who say, man, I can't miss an opportunity to hear the Word. I crave the Word of God. I want to be a part of that. That's the kind of church you want. You want people who love the Word. And you find, as I read these words, I'm going to read Psalm 119, you're going to hear the psalmist having that kind of passion for the Word of God. All right, I'm going to stop preaching. Let's go ahead and read. Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with their whole heart, who also do no wrong but walk in his ways. You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. Then I shall not be put to shame, having my eyes fixed on all your commandments. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous rules. I will keep your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me. How can a young man keep his way pure? By going to church. Well, it doesn't say that, does it? by guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I declare all the rules of your mouth. In the way of your testimonies I delight as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. I will delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word. Deal bountifully with your servant that I may live and keep your word. Open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. I am a sojourner on the earth. Hide not your commandments from me. My soul is consumed with longing for your rules at all times. You rebuke the insolent, accursed ones, who wander from your commandments. Take away from me scorn and contempt, for I have kept your testimonies. Even though princes sit plotting against me, your servant will meditate on your statutes. Your testimonies are my delight. They are my counselors. Our weekly catechism. How is the word of God to be read and heard? With diligence, preparation, and prayer, so that we may accept it with faith, store it in our hearts, and practice it in our lives. Amen to that. Would you stand this morning as the deer, number 548 in your hymnal.
As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. Spirit, you alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love so much more than anything. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire.
Seated. That song, by the way, was by special request of a Byron Everts. So I mention that not necessarily to focus on Byron as everybody looks over and stares at him. But if you have a hymn favorite or request or whatever, talk to me. We'll see if I can squeeze that in. Okay? So anyway. Speaking of hymns, wanted to mention today at 4 o'clock at the Presbyterian Church, there's going to be Robbie is going to do kind of a history of some sacred hymns, and then we're going to be singing them and such. So that might be something that you may want to be a part of. I'm kind of, it depends on my nap schedule today, but I'm contemplating being down there. So that would be a wonderful occasion, I think. Anybody want to participate in that? And I also just want to mention right before we go to prayer here how much I greatly appreciate so much of your kindness and gifts I've gotten throughout this month for pastor appreciation. I can tell you I always feel a little awkward talking about it, but I greatly, greatly appreciate every one of you, and your kindness and generosity is wonderful. But honestly, this is not a hard job. You people are pretty easy to love, so appreciate every one of you. Thank you so much. And whoever came up with that sign back there, I need to use you for some marketing stuff. That is fantastic. So, corny joke involved as well, which is also right up my alley. I like that. So, well done. Thank you. Appreciate it. Prayer needs. We need to pray for Randall. He is home. I was there yesterday. He's not quite his cantankerous self that I'm used to him being. He's a little bit more subdued, and I imagine going through a pretty intense surgery and having a kidney removed will do that. But keep him in your prayers, as well as I'm sure he'd be okay with you stopping by to visit him and trying to encourage him, maybe pray with him. So, but he is home and on the mend. Anyone else prayer needs this morning? Yeah, Lynn. You say Sheldon? Sheldon, okay. Open heart surgery does not sound... Oh. I seldom hear that. Sorry.
Okay.
All right, yeah, Barb? Okay. Okay, anyone else? Oh, absolutely, yep. I'm writing down as you speak, I'm writing down my mother, because you said my mother. We'll go with your mother. Yes, Charlotte. So hard. Kay McNeil lost her mother, and Claude Carmen. His eye is still recovering. He saw a specialist this week, and there's been a little bit of improvement, but they did tell him it'd probably be a couple of months before the double vision that he's been experiencing goes away, and hopefully it will go away, and that's what we're praying. Yeah? That sounds like a lot of work. Yeah. That's wonderful. And God bless them for loving all those kids. But boy, that's a lot of kids. All right. Anyone else this morning? Yes. Okay. Jack Kendall. Pray for Jack. Still out in Towanda? Okay. Long-term care at Towanda. Okay. Very good. Anyone else this morning? Let's go to prayer. Lord Jesus, we are thankful that we can bring all these prayers, all these needs, all these requests. We bring them to the one who's capable of hearing these needs and meeting these needs. And Lord, we know that you're going to meet them in accordance with your will as you see fit. We bring them, Lord, because you've told us to bring them. You have commanded us, in fact, in Scripture to cast all of our cares on you. And Lord, part of the reason for that is if we keep these cares and don't give them to you, Lord, that causes a lot of hurt for us. And so it is so beneficial for us to give our burdens to the one who's able to properly carry them. Lord, there's needs mentioned here, needs for strength, needs for healing, needs for hope, needs for comfort. All of these are needs that you can handle. And so we give each and every one of these into your wonderful care. Lord, help us throughout the week to bring these names before you. Help us to take action where we can, maybe visiting Randall or others who need a visit. Lead us and guide us and direct us by your Holy Spirit to not only hear these needs mentioned, but to act in ways that we can to be a blessing. Again, we ask that as we continue in this service, you would speak to our hearts through your word. We pray this all in Christ's name. Amen. Choir, would you come?
Every servant of the Lord, every
another announcement magically and mysteriously appeared on the pulpit here. Operation Christmas Child will be November 14th, Sunday night here, 6 o'clock, well, in the Fellowship Hall, putting together boxes for Operation Christmas Child. So if you want to be a part of that, please do. November 14th, put that on your calendar if you would. Psalm 119, verses 25 through 48. My soul clings to the dust. Give me life according to your word. When I told of my ways, you answered me. Teach me your statutes. Make me understand the way of your precepts, and I will meditate on your wondrous works. My soul melts away for sorrow. Strengthen me according to your word. Put false ways far from me and graciously teach me your law. I have chosen the way of faithfulness. I set your rules before me. I cling to your testimonies, O Lord. Let me not be put to shame. I will run in the way of your commandments when you enlarge my heart. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I will keep it to the end. Give me understanding that I may keep your law and observe it with my whole heart. Lead me in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Incline my heart to your testimonies and not to selfish gain. Turn my eyes from looking at worthless things and give me life in your ways. Confirm to your servant your promise that you may be feared. Turn away the reproach that I dread, for your rules are good. Behold, I long for your precepts. In your righteousness, give me life. Let your steadfast love come to me, O Lord, your salvation according to your promise. Then shall I have an answer for him who taunts me, for I trust in your word. And take not the word of truth utterly out of my mouth, for my hope is in your rules. I will keep your law continually forever and ever, and I shall walk in a wide place, for I have sought your precepts. I will also speak of your testimonies before kings, and shall not be put to shame, for I find my delight in your commandments, which I love. I will lift up my hands toward your commandments, which I love, and I will meditate on your statutes. Amen. So today in our trip through the minor prophets, we're looking at Habakkuk. Isn't that a great name, Habakkuk? Now it's funny, some of these Old Testament names, people have them, you know, they name their child, you know, something like Joshua, right? David, another good one. My son's actually Joshua David. We gave him two great Old Testament names. Know any Habakkuks? Any of you? You ever met a Habakkuk? Right? It's kind of a different name, kind of fun to say. I don't know. It's actually one of those books where probably the majority of Christians, I would imagine, I have no support, no evidence for this. I don't have any proper statistics, but I'm just guessing that the average Christian has never read Habakkuk. Just seems like one of those books that, I don't know, people kind of skip over. But I'm going to tell you, we're going to see some fascinating stuff in this book. It's three chapters. If you haven't read it before today, you're going to hear a little bit about it now, maybe this afternoon, before you go down to the Presbyterian Church, maybe you'll read these three chapters in Habakkuk. Who knows? You might. But here's a question. Have you ever wished that you could have a sit-down dialogue with the Lord to talk to him about some stuff? Anyone? I imagine. I mean, we understand that in our times of prayer, we are certainly expressing our concerns to God. So there's an aspect in which there's a conversation in which we are praying to the Lord and we're speaking to him, right? And certainly we know that God's response to every single one of our needs and concerns is found where? It's found in his word. So no matter what I bring to him, no matter what I struggle with, somebody prior to me has struggled with something similar to that, and the answer to that struggle is found in God's word, isn't it? And so we kind of have that understanding of a dialogue, if you will, but it's not quite the same as sitting down with a cup of coffee and talking to the Lord and having a conversation back and forth. We don't hear audible voices in our living room when we pray to the Lord. If you do, please raise your hand. I know a competent psychiatrist who would be happy to meet with you. Okay? Anyone hearing audible voices from God, please talk to me later. Okay. But I'm talking about this idea that, can you imagine a dialogue, a conversation with the Lord? Wouldn't that be incredible? What would you say if you had that opportunity? Can you think for a moment? What would you say to, if you had, if God says, I'm going to give you a one-on-one, we're going to have a conversation, what would you bring up to him? I'm wondering, maybe you'd ask him why small children get terrible diseases and die while men who are murderers live a long life. Might be something you might want to throw at him, right? Maybe you would ask him when he's coming again to make all things right. Maybe you'd say, Lord, we've kind of made a mess of things down here. When are you returning? When will it be? Maybe you would plead with him to intervene in your life by healing your body or maybe the body of somebody else. Well, the story of Habakkuk is the story of a prophet who has a dialogue with the Lord. And he's very concerned and a bit upset. And he presents his problems to the Lord, and in the book of Habakkuk, we have this dialogue back and forth. We're going to take a look this morning at two problems that Habakkuk has, and then we're going to look at a prayer that Habakkuk offers in chapter 3. You're probably wondering now, what is this dialogue all about? What's Habakkuk all upset about? I'm glad you're concerned. Let's go ahead and take a look. Habakkuk chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you will not hear? Or cry to you violence and you will not save? Why do you make me see iniquity and why do you idly look at wrong? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law is paralyzed and justice never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous, so justice goes forth perverted. What is Habakkuk's initial problem? His problem is with the wickedness of the land in which he lives. He says Judah is surrounded in evil and wickedness, abandoning God's law. Destruction and strife is everywhere. And Habakkuk is concerned. By the way, we know this as well, that in all nations, at all times, anytime God's law is abandoned, what do you have? Strife, wickedness, chaos, violence. And what he does not see is any kind of justice. People are getting away with murder, figuratively and literally. He says the law is paralyzed, justice never goes forth. Now, it's interesting, it's not for lack of knowing the law, right? Judah had the law. They were the ones who received the law. They have the very law of God. It isn't that they don't know how they ought to act. It isn't that the people don't understand what justice is all about. It isn't that they don't know how God expects them to behave. Rather, they are the recipients of God's law. In fact, most of the people of Judah would have, from very young age, would have been taught the law of God, the Torah, the Pentateuch, the books of the law, the books of Moses. They would have memorized huge portions of these. They would have been reciting back to their parents the word of God. They knew the law. They had access. But the problem is what? Just because I know the Word, just because I have the Word, doesn't mean I'm living in accordance with the Word. Have you ever experienced that? Have you ever met somebody who knew the Word of God, but they weren't exactly doing what it said? That's a challenge for all of us, isn't it? It's one thing to know the law. It's one thing to even possess it and even look at it right in front of us. It's quite another thing to actually do what it says. And so here we have men who were supposed to administer justice, and yet they were the very ones who were corrupt. If the ones who are supposed to be administering justice are corrupt, everything's corrupt, isn't it? The result is that all the violence and wickedness just piles up in Judah. And Habakkuk cries out to God because he's sick and tired of the wickedness he sees every day. And it sounds to him like God's not paying attention, right? He says, how long shall I cry for help and you don't hear? Or cry to you violence and you do not save? You make me see iniquity, and why do you idly look at wrong? He's asking some hard questions. He says, God, what's going on? You see, Habakkuk knew that God had promised long, long ago that when Judah and Israel get into this situation where they're abandoning God's law, God promised judgment. God said, I'm going to deal with that. And so he's looking at God saying, hey, you promised to bring judgment. Your people are in wickedness. Where's the judgment? It's interesting. Habakkuk would have known, for instance, Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 45 through 51. And in those verses, we actually find the promise of God's judgment to his people if they wander off and abandon the law. All these curses shall come upon you and pursue you and overtake you till you are destroyed, because you did not obey the voice of the Lord your God to keep his commandments and his statutes that he commanded you. They shall be a sign and a wonder against you and your offspring forever, because you did not serve the Lord your God with joyfulness and gladness of heart. Because of the abundance of all things, therefore, you shall serve your enemies whom the Lord will send against you, in hunger and thirst, in nakedness and lacking everything. And he will put a yoke of iron on your neck until he has destroyed you. The Lord will bring a nation against you from far away, from the end of the earth, swooping down like the eagle, a nation whose language you do not understand, a hard-faced nation who shall not respect the old or show mercy to the young. It shall eat the offspring of your cattle and the fruit of your ground until you are destroyed. It also shall not leave you grain, wine, or oil, the increase of your herds or the young of your flock until they have caused you to perish. Habakkuk knew those words and knew that God had promised judgment, and yet he sees no judgment. And he says, God, where are you? What is going on? What are you doing? Why are you not acting? And in a wonderful and surprising way, God responds. This isn't one of those one-direction conversations. God doesn't ignore Habakkuk's complaint. God doesn't ignore the problem. God responds. And you're probably wondering what he said, aren't you? Well, here it is. God says, look among the nations and see, wonder and be astounded. For I am doing a work in your days that you would not believe if told. For behold, I am raising up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation, who march through the breadth of the earth to seize dwellings not their own. They are dreaded and fearsome. Their justice and dignity go forth from themselves. Their horses are swifter than leopards, more fierce than the evening wolves. Their horsemen press proudly on. Their horsemen come from afar. They fly like an eagle, swift to devour. They all come for violence, all their faces forward. They gather captives like sand. At kings they scoff, and at rulers they laugh. They laugh at every fortress, for they pile up earth and take it. Then they sweep by like the wind and go on, guilty men whose own might is their God. Now, God's answer to Habakkuk should not have been surprising. If you look at Deuteronomy and you look at Habakkuk and you compare what God promised to what's coming, it's pretty similar, isn't it? It was a fulfillment of what God had promised to the people of Israel in Deuteronomy chapter 28. And those who had failed to obey the law of God could rightly expect judgment to come from a foreign nation. God said so. And you would think that God's answer would have been a help to Habakkuk, that it would have satisfied, okay, well, I asked God, where's judgment coming? And God said, it's coming, and it's coming quick. And it's something that should not have surprised Habakkuk. And yet, was Habakkuk satisfied with God's answer? Nope, not a bit. Because this leads us to Habakkuk's second problem. Let's go back in this dialogue here. We got verses 12 and 13. Habakkuk now responds back to God and says, "Are you not from everlasting, O Lord, my God, my Holy One? We shall not die. O Lord, you have ordained them as a judgment, and you, O rock, have established them for reproof. You, who are of purer eyes than to see evil and cannot look at wrong, why do you idly look at traitors and remain silent when the wicked swallows up the man more righteous than he?" Who's he talking about? He's talking about these coming men. They're called Chaldeans here. The land of Chaldea is the land that we would call Babylon. These are the Babylonians that are coming. So just so you know that when you see Chaldea, the Chaldeans, we're talking about Babylon. All right? And he says here, "Why do you remain silent when the wicked swallows up the man more righteous than he?" In other words, the ones coming to bring judgment, they're more wicked than Judah is. And this is Habakkuk's hang-up. He says, how in the world? I get it that we need judgment. In fact, I even asked you to bring judgment, but you're using them? Are you kidding me? You're using Babylon to bring judgment to Judah? They're far worse than we are. Habakkuk didn't have a problem with God bringing judgment. He had a problem with the instrument of judgment that God chose to use. God's using the Babylonians? They're worse than we are. And his complaint is well made, isn't it? And notice that God doesn't condemn him for asking the question. But here's what we need to see in this, and that is that the bottom line is God is sovereign. God is going to bring whatever he needs to bring, whatever he chooses to bring judgment. Now, the reality is, it's kind of silly for Habakkuk to demand that a ungodly nation not be used to bring judgment. All nations are ungodly. This is one of those pesky little truths that we keep on stumbling upon, right? That no one is righteous, Scripture says, not one. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So were there any godly nations that God could have used to bring judgment? No, because they don't exist, because they're made up of people who are all ungodly. Even the people of Judah, who ought to have been the standard of righteousness in the world, they ought to have been the ones leading the way and demonstrating the light and the glory of God to all the nations, weren't doing it, were they? Those who had the law, who were chosen by God, had abandoned their very role in being God's light to the nations. The people of Judah had the law. Babylon wasn't given the law. Egypt didn't have the law. Assyria wasn't given the law. The people of Israel were given the law, and yet they had abandoned it. But any nation God could have chosen was going to be ungodly. But here's the deal. God is king, and God is the ruler of all. And he'll use whatever he chooses to use to accomplish his good will and his good purpose. Do you know that even Satan himself is used by God for ultimately his good purpose? Satan tempts you. Satan lies to you. Satan condemns you, and it gives you the opportunity and the occasion to grow stronger in your faith as you learn to counter the lies of the enemy with the truth of God's word, as you learn that even in the midst of those trials and struggles, your faith in God grows stronger because you cling to him like nothing before, because you know that you have nothing else to cling to. God uses even Satan himself as part of his sovereign plan. And we say, well, wait a minute, God. Listen, I'm okay with you doing a work in my life, but couldn't you use something else? And he says, child, I know what I'm doing. Stand still. This is going to hurt a little. Right? And friends, sometimes it hurts more than a little, doesn't it? Sometimes we go through things that are horrifying, and they ache and they hurt. And we say, how can God possibly be a part of this, not knowing that God's orchestrating all of that for a divine purpose that is absolutely good? God is a master at working all things, even the tragedies, even the sinfulness of mankind, into something that will ultimately bring him glory and cause us to be more shaped into the likeness of Christ. We don't get it because we can't see the bigger picture. I'm very confined to only seeing what's going on right here, right now. I can't see all that God's working together in his sovereign plan. Do you understand that that's one of the things that's going to be so excellent about heaven? Friends, there's coming a day when we are in his presence ultimately, and we'll look back at our lives and others' lives, and oh my Lord, I didn't know you were working this event and that event, and I was so upset when that happened, but I didn't see how you took that event and you turned it with this, and you were weaving something together that was more beautiful than I could have ever imagined. I should have just trusted you. But I didn't, because I was weak and I didn't understand. God is a master at working those things all together. Habakkuk couldn't possibly have seen God's bigger picture here, and we can't either. And it's why what is best for us to do is have a faith that our sovereign God knows what he's doing. No, I don't understand what he's doing, but I know his character, I know his nature, and I know I can trust him. I know he's good always, even if it doesn't feel good. Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. An interesting glimpse into some sibling rivalry, if you will. Genesis tells us about Joseph, who, by proper argument, Joseph was a punk of a kid who got spoiled by his father. His dad was not a good dad, and so he treats him as his favorite, gets him a special robe that none of the other guys got, right? And so Joseph would come out in the field flaunting his special coat and talking to his brother. Well, they didn't like it. Read the text and go back and read this. Here comes that dreamer again. It's seething in contempt for him, and contempt that was probably earned by Joseph. So, of course, you know that they go from, well, should we throw him in a well, which they did, and then Reuben was going to go get him back out of there. They don't want to kill him outright, but they could let him starve to death. But then they decide, oh, wait a minute, bonus. There's some slave traders coming through here. Let's sell them into slavery. Sounds like a great plan. Unbelievable. And so after all of these events transpire, we're at the end of Genesis, and all has been reconciled with Joseph's brothers, and God uses Joseph to be a blessing and a salvation to the whole people that would become the people of Israel, right? But hear Joseph's words in Genesis 50. What does he say? As for you, Joseph's brothers, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. Isn't that interesting? Their actions were evil, and yet God says, oh, that didn't take me by surprise. I intended to use that for good. Interesting. Their intentions were evil. God meant it for good and used their actions as part of his master plan that ultimately brings good for Joseph and for the people of Israel. Clearly, God's ways are not our ways, are they? We would never have done that. We would have said, Lord, let's just not have the evil brothers do that whole, you know, selling him into slavery thing. And let's not have that potter's wife make the false accusation thing. And let's not have Joseph go into prison for being falsely accused thing, and so on and so forth. And God says, get out of my way, I know what I'm doing. Romans 8:28, some of you have probably heard this, memorized it, maybe clung on to this verse in a time of trouble, right? And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. Be careful with that verse. Be very careful. Because where it says all things work together for good, you're not the author of the definition of the word good in that sentence. Right? We like to say, okay, God, I see that verse, and I've done some helpful things for you, Lord. I've determined what would be good for me, and I've already established it, so you just need to do those things. You need to work those things together for the good that I declare is good and that I've already defined. And that's not how it works. We know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. Good is defined by Him. And that good, my friend, may not feel good. Do some study, and I mentioned her a few weeks ago, I think. Johnny Erickson Tata has been in that wheelchair now for, 60 years? And she will say in her testimony that that wheelchair has been a part of God's working things together for good and the benefit that has come from her being in that wheelchair. Does that mean that God's working things together felt good for her? Not a bit. And sometimes we go through great loss, great tragedy, great heartache, great hardship, and we say, how in the world can this be any good? I don't have an answer for you necessarily on this side of heaven, how that'll be worked out for good, but I can say with confidence that God knows exactly how it can and will be, and there will come a time in His presence you will look back on your life and say, I see it now. I get it. I understand. Lord, you know what you were doing all the time, didn't you? That terrible thing that happened in my life and I didn't handle it very well, and I whined and I complained, but you still even used that. And you caused me to see things that I needed to see, and you brought about stuff in my life that I would have never had you not used those tragic things. God works things together for good. His definition, not ours, may not feel good, but it is good. Trust His sovereign plan. God's plans are for our good, not for our feel good. And Habakkuk was about to learn that lesson. Let's take a look at the prophet's prayer. This is one of those passages that, again, part of the tragedy of not reading Habakkuk is that you don't end up reading Habakkuk chapter 3. You want to read a powerful passage of Scripture later on today? Read all of Habakkuk chapter 3. I'm just going to read a couple of verses here. Habakkuk now is in a situation where he knows the doom is coming. The Chaldeans are coming. This isn't one of those situations where God is going to relent. He doesn't say, well, if the people of Judah repent, no, he says the Chaldeans are coming. And they did. And they burned Jerusalem, and they took away the people. And that happened. That's a historical reality. And so now Habakkuk has kind of come full circle and come around to basically accepting the fact God's judgment is coming. It's going to be the Chaldeans, that wicked and terrible nation. They're coming, and not somebody better. No, this is who God has chosen, and he has to accept that. Look at Habakkuk's response in anticipation of what's happening. He says, I hear, and my body trembles. My lips quiver at the sound. Rottenness enters into my bones. My legs tremble beneath me. Yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble to come upon people who invade us. You hear what he's saying? Lord, I know they're coming, but I also know their day's coming. Judgment's going to come upon the people of Babylon too. And until that does, he says, though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls. Powerful word here, folks, yet. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God the Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread on my high places. It isn't that Habakkuk wasn't afraid. He's terrified. Did you see the words in verse 16? He is scared out of his socks. although I don't think they had socks. If he had had socks, he would have been scared out of them. Right? I mean, look at the terminology used here. My body trembles. My lips quiver at the sound. Rottenness enters into my bones. My legs tremble beneath me. He's scared. Rightfully so. And we face some pretty scary things at times, don't we? And they're terrifying. Friends, I want to give you encouragement. I want to give you hope, because the hope is found not in that God's not going to bring you through any trouble. That's not scriptural. If you're going to a church somewhere, you know someone, they're going to church, and the pastor tells them, you're not going to go through any trouble as a Christian. That's horse hooey. It's nonsense. It's garbage. It's untrue. No, you're going to go through trouble. Scripture says, Jesus says, in this world you will have trouble. That's the promise. But take courage, I've overcome the world, he says. Right? Here's the comfort, here's the joy. Not that God's going to take everything away. Well, there's coming a day when that'll be the case, but that's not on this earth. That's the next one. But look at what Habakkuk says. Knowing all of this that's coming, knowing the terrible doom that's upon, he says, yet I will rejoice in the Lord, and I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God the Lord is my strength. Friends, find your strength in the Lord. Find your joy in the God of your salvation. We get so fixated on God, you've got to take this away, and God says, oh, wait a second. I'm using that. Right? He brings a tool out of his toolbox, and we say, oh, no, not that one. And he says, hold still. It's going to hurt. But I'm going to bring you through. And I'm going to make something better out of you than you had any idea could ever be made. Find your strength and your joy in the Lord. Friends, I don't know what we're going to face in the coming days in this country. Who knows? I've been thinking that for decades, we're about due for some pretty severe judgment by the Lord. There's enough wickedness piled up here, sufficient for God's judgment. And maybe we'll see that judgment brought against us. Maybe it'll be from another land that's more wicked than we are. Maybe some of you will suffer greatly for the King of Kings. What an honor. What an honor to suffer for the name of Christ. But now's not the time to cower in fear. Now's the time to draw close to God, trusting in his sovereign goodness, knowing that he will ultimately accomplish his perfect will, and it will be good. It will be for our good, but ultimately that is defined as he defines that word, good. He is our joy. He is our strength. Friends, when trouble comes, I want to be that person, and I hope you do too, who says, I feel it coming. I feel trouble coming. But my joy and my strength is in the Lord. I don't know how I'm going to get through it, but I know I serve the one who's going to bring me through it. He's my strength. He is my joy. He is the one that I'm going to cling to like I never have before. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you. We don't get excited necessarily about looking forward to trouble. But you promised we would have trouble. What we look forward to is that you said, take courage, I've overcome the world. Because you've overcome the world, you can provide the strength that we need so that we can be overcomers in your strength. Lord, may we look to you to be our joy, our strength. May we seek you with all of our hearts. Give us a passion for your word. Give us a passion for you. So that when the day of trouble comes, we'll stand in your strength. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Would you stand? Our closing hymn this morning, Take the Name of Jesus With You, number 235 in the hymn book. Lord Jesus, we are so thankful that we have had the privilege of gathering together in your name. Lord, may the word that we've heard today empower us and encourage us and help us to trust you, to find our joy and our strength in you. Empower us today, Lord, by your Holy Spirit, to live what we've heard in the world around us. We pray this in Christ's name and for your glory. Amen. God bless you.